Greetings once again. If you tuned in for our last lecture, you heard me talking about American culture, and you heard me talking about how the Great Depression, while it was terrible when it comes to the human toll, it produced some of the more interesting, some of the more uplifting culture in American history. Unfortunately, this fertile ground when it comes to positive, uplifting, small d democratic culture was also fertile ground for the darker side, the uglier side of what might loosely be called American populism. And certainly that bleeds into culture. Today, what I want to do is I want to introduce you to a very important and, in my own humble opinion, very misused word in American society today. And that would be fascism, okay? Simply put, what fascism is going to boil down to is three clear tenets, right? Tent posts, pillars, whatever you want to call them. But there's three things that I think that you can associate with fascism that will help you, at least for the purposes of this class. Number one, fascism does not like democracy, right? It does not like majority of rule. It does not like the empowerment of all people within the political society. Fascismo is going to be a term that's going to be coined by maybe the father of fascism, a guy from Italy by the name of Benito Mussolini. And what fascismo meant, as far as Mussolini intended it, was the bundling of power. Power is bundled into the hands of one individual. That's the first tenet of fascism, that it's the opposite of democracy, it's a dictatorship, it's a one-man rule, right? The second tenet that I need you to be mindful of, fascists and fascism generally like to blame, to scapegoat the problems of a society on racial, ethnic, or political minorities. Probably the most infamous, most well-known example that I can point to would be Adolf Hitler and the Jews of Germany and eventually Eastern Europe. It's not the fault of Germans that the economy is faltering. Clearly, this is the fault of the Jews, right? And so that is going to be an example of how fascists like to blame, to scapegoat racial, ethnic minorities for the problems of a country. They're doing that to insulate, to ensure their power. Nobody questions their dictatorial authority. Lastly, fascists and fascism love a good old-fashioned military conquest. Unlike communism, that wants world revolution for allegedly some better, broader goal, a workers' control of the government, fascism just wants to go on these conquests to demonstrate its greatness, right? Unlike the communists that want to lift all borders, want to become one great big huge country, the fascists really like their borders. The people in Germany definitely want those people east of Germany and even west of Germany to know that they're not Germans, and those borders are very meaningful. And so that's what I need you to understand about fascism and fascists. Dictatorial rule, the blaming of ethnic racial minorities for the problems, scapegoating, if you will, and military conquest. If you understand those three things, you're going to be fine for this class. Now, what are we looking at there? What are we looking at on that PowerPoint slide? Well, what you're looking at, guys, would be an example of fascism of the American variety, okay? I would venture to guess that everybody that's watching this now could tell me that that individual wearing the white hood is a member of the Ku Klux Klan. The guy next to him, interesting outfit that he's got, he's actually a spin-off of the Ku Klux Klan. It's going to come about in the 1930s, and they're going to call themselves the Black Legion. The Black Legion was a collection of Klansmen in places like Michigan, Ohio, Indiana, Wisconsin, the urban North, the industrial North, that felt that the Klan had lost its edge. It wasn't quite crazy enough. So they spun off, they created their own organization that they began calling the Black Legion. And in particular, the Black Legion is really going to take aim at really immigrants. Immigrants are really number one on its public enemies list. And the reason that they take aim at these immigrants are primarily because they see them as taking jobs that should, by all rights, be going to what they see as real Americans, their terminology, not mine. But in any case, they would go on these really violent night rides and round people of the immigrant variety up and send them out of town, burn down their houses, and sometimes much, much worse. Very, very violent, and it took the FBI a long, long time to eventually break this apart. But the Black Legion is a very good example of American-born fascism in the sense that what they're doing is they're blaming this ethnic minority, racial, what would have been considered a racial and an ethnic minority, for the problems of the country, and they're really advocating a strongman dictatorial rule. So as you can see, guys, we're not hurting. There's no shortage of American-born fascism, and that's what I want to talk about a little bit with this slide. The individual that you're looking at the top of the screen there is the Louisiana-born Huey Long, or as he liked to be called, Huey Kingfish Long. He's another good example of a fascist. He is going to enact this populist, man of the people policy that he called Share Our Wealth. The idea was simple enough. He blamed corporations and very, very wealthy Louisianans for the Great Depression. He felt that they needed to pay more than their fair share to rectify the situation, which is why he levied such massive, massive taxes directed at these individuals, so that they could really kind of play a part in the recovery effort. Now, to be sure, he's using this huge tax base to build schools in Louisiana. He's sending these poor kids, these farmers' kids, to school in Louisiana, and not only is he doing that, he's putting books in their hands. This is going to resonate with the people that, on the one hand, had lost everything in the Great Depression, and on the other hand, say, well, shouldn't the rich be paying a little bit more, considering they were, in their minds, instrumental in causing the collapse? It's true that Huey Long certainly had a populist appeal. And it's also true that schools and books and roads and you name it were built under his time as governor of Louisiana. But it's also true that he is an example of American-born fascism. There were undercover police forces that were answerable to him and him alone. And if you started saying things or doing things that he ex wasn't exactly cool with, bad things could happen to you. If you're thinking about this in a European context, that'd be the brown shirts and under Hitler, it'd be the black shirts under Benito Mussolini. He shut down local governments in places like Alexandria, Baton Rouge, New Orleans. He's an example of fascism because he was moving in the opposite direction of democracy. He's an example of a dictator. And as a matter of fact, one of the people that's most worried about Huey Long and where his aspirations lied was Franklin Roosevelt. Now, eventually, Roosevelt's fears would be eased quite a bit. Somebody assassinates Huey Long, but this is another good example of American-born fascism. The last individual that I'd like you to be mindful of would be the individual at the bottom of the screen there. That's Father Charles Coughlin. As you might guess, he's a Catholic priest. He's got a parish in the greater Detroit area, but more than anything else, he really is a radio superstar in the 1930s. Over a million listeners that would listen on a regular basis. He had a nationally syndicated program. It was coast to coast. And what he did on this radio program is really kind of examine and critique the approaches of cracking this code that was the Great Depression. In Father Coughlin's mind, the Great Depression was caused by an international Jewish banking conspiracy. So on the one hand, there's some good old-fashioned anti-Semitism at work there. He's blaming a racial and ethnic minority for the problems of a country. On the other hand, what he wanted Franklin Roosevelt to do is also another very good example of fascism. He wants Roosevelt to nationalize the banks. Similar to what Adolf Hitler was doing in Germany, he felt that because these bankers, and in particular Jewish bankers, had caused this, the federal government had every right to nationalize, to take over the banks. And you can say what you want about Franklin Roosevelt, right? Seriously, you can't. I'm not saying that he fixed all of our problems. But in my mind, FDR's major accomplishment certainly by 1940, his major accomplishment is the preservation of liberal democracy. And by liberal democracy, I don't mean like Barack Obama liberal democracy as much as I mean the rule of the people liberal democracy. That's not the case in Germany. That's not the case in Italy. That's not the case in Japan, right? And by the way, all of those countries had forms of democracy, I guess you could call them, before they were ruled over in a fascist way. And so Father Coughlin is a good example of American-born fascism, both in the sense that who he's blaming and what he wants the federal government to do, right? Now, as I mentioned before, we don't see the rise of fascism in the United States the way that we see it abroad. And the big reason why is Franklin Roosevelt. On the one hand, I think that you can say that, well, that never ended the Great Depression. The New Deal softened the blow of the Great Depression, and the American people loved FDR for that. It absolutely preserved liberal democracy in that end. I mean, that's part of what I had made mention of a second ago, is that's part of his accomplishment, is saving liberal democracy. And the bottom line is, Franklin Roosevelt was very, very popular, and so the Huey Longs and the Father Coughlins just never got traction the way that they did in places like Italy and Germany. But you do see fascism rising abroad. You see it in Japan. And part of what you're seeing under Emperor Hirohito in Japan is obviously a dictatorial rule, but you see a vicious military conquest, right? It begins in the early 1930s in northern China in Manchuria. And the Japanese are not only going to go on this conquest, they're going to wipe Chinese towns, villages, even cities off the face of the earth in very vicious ways. Probably the most notorious example that you can point to, if you're so inclined, would be the Rape of Nanjing, a city in northern China that ultimately the Chinese simply sacrificed in order for the greater protection of the rest of China. But some really vicious things going on, slaughter in Eastern Asia. In Italy, you got this guy right here. This is Benito Mussolini, guy that's probably most responsible for coining the phrase fascism. But Italy's a democracy before it was a fascist dictatorship. Mussolini is able to suspend many of the democratic practices and the democratic rights of Italians, and part of the way that he's going about doing this is appealing to populism. What Mussolini said that his major accomplishment was making the trains run on time, getting government services to actually function in a way that would be considered efficient and proficient. But you've got fascism going on in Italy. In Spain, you've got the rise of fascism. And that would be this individual right here. This would be General Francisco Franco that will fight the Spanish Republicans. And by Republicans, I just mean small R Republicans, constitutionalists, if you will. He'll fight them in the Spanish Civil War and he'll win. And he'll implement a fascist dictatorship that actually is not going to end in Spain until 1975, right? So you've got fascism in Spain as well. But the big one, as I'm sure you're well aware, is the guy at the bottom of the screen there, that would be Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler comes to power in Germany, not that much different than the other examples that I've told you about, but by appealing to the populism of the German people. He never missed a chance to tell people of the raw deal that Germany got during World War I, the fact that the suffering of the German people was not due to any shortcoming or any mistakes that the Germans themselves had made. There had to be somebody that sold them out, right? They were doing quite well for themselves in the war, thank you very much. So he appeals to German populism at a time period where you've got widespread discontent and you've got widespread German suffering, and ultimately that's where he's going to bed his power. You've got Germany, which, like Italy, was a democracy until Hitler began suspending various aspects of German democratic rights and principles. And in addition to a dictatorship, Adolf Hitler is also targeting racial and ethnic minorities. Of course, the Jews, as we've already pointed out, but other racial ethnic minorities as well. Slavs, an ethnic group of Eastern European origin. Communist trade union leaders were not very friendly toward Hitler, and Hitler had many of them jailed, many of them executed, actually. Homosexuals. I'm sure you're all familiar with the Star of David that eventually Hitler would force all German Jews to wear to identify themselves. All known homosexuals were ordered to wear a pink triangle on their jacket or their coat as well to identify themselves, because Hitler put a lot of blame for German suffering on them as well, right? And so fascism abroad is really the threat. It's not really in the United States, where it never really gets any traction. It's got traction abroad. Now, when these storm clouds are gathering over Europe, when people like Adolf Hitler are signing alliances with Benito Mussolini and later on the Japanese, you begin to see hostile takeover country after country. Hitler's able to annex countries like Austria-Hungary under a policy known as Anschluss, the reunification of German-speaking people, proclaiming that people in Austria were German-speaking people. They were treated as second-class citizens, and that's why he was trying to unite them with the fatherland that was Germany. Hostile takeover in Czechoslovakia. He's annexing these countries. And the guy that is trying to broker peace in Europe, the British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, actually met Hitler in Munich and warned him that if he moved on Poland, if you try to take over Poland, the British and the French will have no other recourse but to declare war, because you will be in full breach of the Treaty of Versailles, right? So in any case, Chamberlain went back to London proclaiming that he had achieved peace in his time. Couldn't have been more wrong about that. Simply put, what Chamberlain did was appease Hitler, and every time Hitler took over a new country, it only whetted his appetite to do it again. That begs the question what the United States is doing, right? And simply put, what the United States is doing is desperately trying to stay neutral. We ended World War I with such a bitter taste in our mouth that we vowed to stay out of European affairs whenever and wherever we could. What you're looking at Franklin Roosevelt sign right there is a law called the Neutrality Act. And what the Neutrality Act said was, if you are a country at war, we will not sell you military products. Doesn't matter that we're in the middle of the Great Depression. We're so desperately trying to stay out of war that we won't sell you any military products if you happen to be at war. A couple years later, in 1937, he will enact a policy known as cash and carry. This is also designed to keep America neutral, in the sense that it says, even if you are not presently at war, you need to pay us in cash for our military products, and you need to come get it and haul it away yourself, right? You want one of those destroyers that are built in Boston, you need to pay us in cash, which, let's be honest, not a lot of people had that kind of money laying around, and you're going to need to come over to Boston and haul it back with you, okay? We don't really think of the 1930s as that anti-war of a decade. You typically think of the 1960s when it comes to the 20th century. But pacifist groups like the IWW, demonstrations on city streets, on college campuses, no shortage of them. As a matter of fact, there's one example that I'd like you to be mindful of a group of Americans that really do see the threat posed by international fascism, and that would be what we call the Popular Front. Now, I don't want you to get too bogged down in this, but I do want to reference it because it is important for what will come later on in this course. What the Popular Front was a communist policy whereby the Soviet Union, the epicenter of communism, suspended this idea of bringing communism to every corner of the world because it saw fascism as the greater threat. What it advised communist parties in Britain, in France, in the United States, what it advised those communist parties to do was to team up with other anti-fascist groups, team up with Democrats, team up with Republicans, team up with socialists, team up with anybody who is an enemy of fascism, because Hitler and Mussolini were clearly, as far as Russia was concerned, clearly the greater enemy here. You're looking at an example of an American populist front institution, and that would be the Abraham Lincoln Brigade. The Abraham Lincoln Brigade was a group of American fighters that actually enlisted in the Spanish Civil War to go over and fight the fascists under Francisco Franco's leadership. Now, obviously, they're not successful, but it does demonstrate that at a time that everybody was very anti-war and very much in favor of isolation, the Popular Front, through the Abraham Lincoln Brigade, certainly recognizes the threat that international fascism poses. But the bottom line is this: by the early 1940s, Adolf Hitler is giving the Britons and the United States an offer that they simply can't refuse. In September 1939, Hitler moves and he invades Poland, and this causes both France and Britain to declare war on him. The kind of war that Hitler is embarking upon is typically called Blitzkrieg, lightning war. Fast, massive strikes that hit the enemy so hard and so quickly that they barely even know that there's a war, and he slices through Poland like it's just a hot knife going through warm butter. Does a U-turn, comes back and gets ready to fight the French. Very heavy winter, tanks can't get through, and the joke in London was not really so much Blitzkrieg as so much as it is Sitzkrieg. But I'll tell you something else: nobody was laughing when those snowbanks thawed that following spring. Hitler has a sweeping conquest of France. So do the math here with me, guys. He has conquered Poland. By 1940, he's now conquered France. You're looking at German troops marching through the streets of Paris down there at the bottom of that screen. Hitler's the master, either by conquest or alliance, Benito Mussolini. He's the master of Western Europe. He's the master of all of Europe, for that matter. Really, there's only two holdouts by the summer of 1940. That one would be Great Britain, the other would be the Soviet Union. Back in the United States, Franklin Roosevelt can see the writing on the wall, and he issues what comes to be known as his Four Freedoms speech. Now, the whole purpose of his Four Freedoms speech is to prepare the United States for the inevitability of war, to prepare the American people. He knows that Hitler's never going to be satisfied if he has control of this country or that country. It's not as if he'll just, conquer Britain and then he'll be satiated. He's never going to be satiated, and you can't negotiate with somebody like that. But these Four Freedoms are FDR's ideas when it comes to what is necessary when it comes to keeping freedom throughout the world: freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from want. Keep in mind, it was a lack of sustenance that brought Hitler to rise in the first place. And lastly, freedom from fear. Together, these are the four essential freedoms from preventing the Adolf Hitlers, the Benito Mussolinis of the world from rising. Now, I want to make sure that I mention something before we go any further. 1940 should have been Franklin Roosevelt's last year as president. Keep in mind, he was elected in 32, re-elected in 36. Every president before him has served two back-to-back terms and called it a day. But we are talking about a time period before there's a constitutional amendment that says that he can't run for another term. And the bottom line was, there were a lot of people within the Democratic Party that wanted him for an unprecedented third term. In 1940, he agrees to run again, and he's elected for an unprecedented third term in office. And one of the things that Roosevelt has to figure out is, how do you buy yourself some time? We're not ready for war right now. We had pretty much scrapped our military in the aftermath of World War I. To do that, to buy yourself some time, you got to have Britain hold on. Now, Britain's an island nation, and it hasn't been invaded since William the Conqueror. That's one of the primary reasons that Hitler had such a big problem, Napoleon had such a big problem for him. It's just difficult to do that, to invade an island. But that did not stop Hitler from sending the Luftwaffe, the German Air Force, to bomb Britain back to the Stone Age. That rubble that you're looking at there, that's the aftermath of what comes to be known as the Battle of Britain. Just a massive bombing raid of London. And the problem that Winston Churchill, the guy that you see Franklin Roosevelt leaning over and talking to there in that image, the problem that Churchill has is he's now at war. And so what that means is he can't buy military products from the Americans. The problem that FDR has is it's difficult. It's really difficult to envision Britain hanging on if they're not able to buy aircraft carriers and battleships and submarines. Keep in mind, Britain's an island nation, and it's only as strong as its navy. Roosevelt's got to find a way to get around this Neutrality Act. They do in 1940 in what comes to be known as the Lend-Lease Act. What the Lend-Lease Act says is I can't sell you this battleship, but I can lend it to you. It's sort of like lending somebody your Coke. They drink it, it's gone, it's theirs, right? I can't, sell you this fleet of aircrafts, but I can lease them to you, right? It's a way of circumventing, getting around that law that says that you couldn't officially sell them this. And so what you got in 1940 is this de facto American-British alliance. And what Roosevelt's trying to do is give Britain the ability to hang on, stand up to the British, or excuse me, stand up to the Germans long enough before he can prepare the American people and the American military for war. And as fate would have it, it's actually going to be an act of war that propels the United States into World War II. And it's not Germany. For all of our huffing and puffing and our focus on the Nazis and what's going on over there, it's actually the Japanese that bombed the United States and launched us into this war. Japan had a formal alliance with Germany. And keep in mind, for the last 40 years, what you've seen in the Pacific region is this growing rivalry between the United States and Japan. And in 1941, Japan just felt that war with the Americans was inevitable, and because it was inevitable, they needed to have the upper hand, which is what went into their decision to bomb the American Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor in Hawaii. It's Pearl Harbor that will launch the United States into World War II. The level of shock and surprise. There's really no modern day example that I can point to, short of 9/11, September 11th, that would make sense to modern Americans. But this was an act of aggression, a completely unprovoked act of aggression. And in the aftermath of the bombing, Franklin Roosevelt will ask Congress to declare war on the Empire of Japan, which it does overwhelmingly. It's this that launches America into the war. Now, Germany, Japan's ally, declared war on the United States, which is exactly what Franklin Roosevelt wanted, because he knew he could never convince the American people to fight a two-front war. But by making Hitler make the first move, he got America involved in both the Pacific and the European theaters, because let's be honest, we were going to need to fight the Germans one way or another anyway. Naturally, we need to do everything we possibly can, as quickly as we possibly can, to mobilize for war. So you can understand how and why Congress is going to give Roosevelt unprecedented authority to wage the war by any means he deems necessary, which is what went into the thinking in the War Powers Act of 1941. What the War Powers Act is going to do is it's going to dramatically and unprecedentedly expand the role, scope, and power of the president, of the executive branch of government. Basically, what the War Powers Act says is anything that the president wants to do, as long as it's in the name of winning the war, he can do it. Right? You want to bomb Japan back to the Stone Age? You don't need our permission for that. Just do it, right? This has the potential to do great, great good, and you will see it do great, great good. As a matter of fact, you'll see it the next time we meet. It also has the potential to do great, great harm. I want to end our class by, or this lecture anyway, by pointing out one of those great evils, and that would be an executive order. Executive order straight from the president. Executive Order 9066. What Executive Order 9066 does is it essentially allows the federal government to round up people of Japanese ancestry and intern them in these camps, most of which are concentrated there on the West Coast. You have to understand that the element of surprise convinced a lot of Americans, this shock convinced a lot of us, that Pearl Harbor had to be an inside job. People of Japanese ancestry, they sold us out, they gave secrets to our enemies, and that's why Pearl Harbor was so effective. Well, clearly this was not the case, but you take the shock and surprise of Pearl Harbor, and you combine it with that anti-Asian, anti-Japanese sentiment that had really crystallized in places like California, and you combine it finally with the War Powers Act that gives the federal government, and Franklin Roosevelt in particular, the power to do this, and you can see how this has the potential to do great evil. Okay? Now, what's as important as the military aspect of World War II is how the war itself changes life in America, how things evolve because of and during the war. And that's what we'll talk about the next time I meet you.